What countries are interesting you in terms of whiskey other than Scotland right now, and the major whiskey producing nations? What countries are you most interested in seeing whiskeys from and trying?
I'm interested in them all. I think there's a global shakeout. I think it's no longer about Scotch whisky, although Scotch whisky retains a very important presence, particularly the brand producers who are concentrating on quality presentation. But things are so international now, Japanese whisky, American whisky, and here you and I, we're recording this right here now in Canada, Victoria Whisky Festival, and we've witnessed there's three generations of Canadian whisky have been at this festival, and one of the most exciting, and I want to give them a mention, is young Peter up at Victoria Spirits here in Vancouver Island, and basically he's a young lad making gin in a German still, and he said, you know, I'd like to do something different. I'd like to do a little bit of whisky. Let's put some whisky through and see what we get. Now, I'm not quite sure whether this happened by mistake, but when I got to sample a little bit of that lad's whisky, what I noticed was a little bit of the aromatics from the previous gin distillation had come through into the great spirit of whisky, and they really came together beautifully. I think both you and I have sampled it. We're well impressed, and I think there's huge potential here in Canada. And we're going beyond whisky. Alcohol is about the opportunity to carry flavour. And whether it be whisky or mezcal or Armagnac or whatever, if any distiller anywhere in the world can understand the local flavours in the fields, in the forests, in the hills, wherever, isolate them and put them into the spirit in a successful balance and personality of spirit, then they're going to have something they can sell, and it's quickly going to get noticed. There'll never be high volumes, but as long as you've got sufficient variety out there, then I think there's going to be enough for everybody.
Now, I saw Peter's distillery today, as a matter of fact. We were up there, and I talked to them, along with Davin de Kergemuth from the Maniacs, about your theory about the still.
Mm-hmm.
And he went through his cleaning process with us.
Right.
And I think that the gin aromatics that are coming into his whiskey are coming more from the air contact, because the cask he's aging in is in the same room with all of his aromatics, and in the same room where he's distilling gin most of the time. I think it's coming in through the wood and through the contact with the air and not the still, because he's going through doing full acid washes and everything before he does his whiskey runs, and the still after he does his gin runs. So I think it's more that combination of the air contact and the wood contact with the air itself, like we get, for instance, on Isla with the seaweed and the brine notes that come in through the wood from the surrounding air and the salt and the sea. I think that's how he's getting that gin in there, but I would agree with you. He is doing some really interesting things. I can't wait to see what he does in 3 or 4 years.
Yeah. On that subject, again, I was certainly making an assumption to a certain extent, and inevitably you do that. But you've tasted it yourself. Did you notice any sort of ginniness about that? It's definitely there.
Oh, it's there, definitely. There's a nice little juniper note to it. There's some nice aromatic notes to it. But I'm just trying to figure out where it came from as well. But it's a very interesting difference, and it's what really makes whiskey unique, is the terroir, or whatever you want to call it. You can have two stills and two distilleries located right next to each other producing dramatically different spirits.
Yeah, and your excellent example, Glenfiddich and Mulvenny, right bang next door, and totally two different results. But it's true what you say, there is so much ambiguity about terroir, and yet the fact that we recognise it, we taste it, we smell it, means that it simply cannot be dismissed. That there are those who, for the convenience of industrial storage and manufacture, would wish to dispense with terroir, and equally there's those who perhaps over-egg the pudding with terroir to try and elevate the reputation of what they're doing. But with spirit, we're going right back to the alchemists. Now, it's interesting, I've been listening to a program on the radio, I think it was a BBC food program, they were talking about the rising number of eau de vie spirit producers in Europe, and how stills went back to the Arabs, you know, developed and pioneered the use of stills and distillation. But they were talking that in one of the Mediterranean islands, they've actually discovered a ceramic still which was used by the Greeks. And when I mentioned this to a friend, he says, well, hang about, my pal's Chinese. He started studying history in China and archaeology, and they've discovered this pot in the ground, and it shows a bamboo still, an illustration of a bamboo still that you wouldn't think that exists. But there's no reason that you can't have a wooden still, because they have them in South America. In fact, they're still using them for El Dorado rum, using actual stills, firing up stills that have got wooden walls and wooden sides to them. So the alchemists, I think, I do tend to kind of wonder when I'm talking, bear with me. Not unusual. Thank goodness I can limit my videos to 10 minutes, I've been in real trouble. But the alchemists, their idea was to take the essence and concentrate it and refine it and purify it and get something which was the purification of its prime existence. And I think that's what distillers do. We're drinking the spirit now, we're enjoying it. But what we really appreciate is, however it's done, if it can capture in an alchemic way the location, the grain, the terroir, the time of the year, the qualities of the wood it was matured in, and the glass flasks it was matured in, then great. We appreciate quality. And it certainly separates, elevates the quality of life, does it not? We use our senses in our existence. We can sit at home drinking crude spirit, watching mindless stuff on telly, but if we get out and about, use our eyes and our galleries, use our ears and appreciate music, then we're using our nose and our taste to appreciate whatever has been caught in the spirit contained in a glass. And that is a life. Lift.
What spirits have impressed you most in the last few months? On the whiskey side, let's stick to whiskeys instead of other stuff. What whiskeys have you been most impressed with?
Well, let's start with Benromach, 10-year-old.
That was a crack.
It's an absolute belter. Again, a little bit more peatiness in there. Smallest stills on Speyside. A classic, ambiguous Speyside signature. But when you get a couple of guys who seriously know what they're doing to get down to business, leave them to get on with it, and then you get some absolutely amazing results in the glass. And I've got to mention Blagnac as well, because Blagnac was literally dragged back from extinction by a dedicated little team. And it's a fantastic distillery to visit, tucked down in the south of Scotland, and they are basically hands-on producing a fantastically complex interpretation of what has previously been a pleasant, but not top-flight signature. They're taking a modest, still personality and making the best of and splendid job. So big salute, big shout for Raymond and all the team down in Blagnac. A big fan of theirs.
And I wish that someday the contractual limits that they have with Diageo on what they can produce will be relaxed at some point, so that they can produce more of that spirit. For those who aren't aware, when Raymond Armstrong bought Blagnac, it came with the contractual limits that essentially at first said he couldn't distill anything there. They could only use it for a tourist site, and he was eventually allowed to distill, I think, about 100,000 liters a year, or something like that.
Something like that.
Something like that, and